What I've seen is that there are actually categories in the National Credit Act about renters' credits. So there are three categories. So firstly, what must the consumer have done before they go into this agreement? So if the person actually selling the property via installment sale agreement doesn't do the necessary assessments, there's actually a lot of defenses that the purchaser has against the seller. Mm-hmm. So there's three categories of reckless credit, which is quite interesting. The first credit category is where the credit provider doesn't do an assessment at all. So they were supposed to, but they chose not to. The second category is where the assessment was done, and you could see that this person would be in bad credits, but you went along with it anyway. And then there's the one where you did the agreement, but the assessment, but you're pretending that you didn't, so you can still go ahead with the agreement. Then there's defenses. So the different defenses is obviously according to the categories. So the first two categories, you can get an order setting aside the entire agreement, or you can get an order suspending it until the court has an agreement with the seller and the purchaser, where it kind of is more of a mediation. And then under the third category, when you actually just pretend you didn't see it, it's actually seen a lot worse than the other two categories, and that is they restructure the entire agreement. But the really interesting thing that I found about the third category is when they restructure it, you go back into the agreement afterwards, but you can no longer charge interest. So even if this is a mortgage bond and you still have to pay the bank interest, my question to you is, what happens to that interest owed on the bond? Because the person purchasing is still paying the installments towards the bond, but is no longer paying interest. What happens then?
I think, Alexa, on the installment sales agreement, if the problem there is going to be that I think, especially if the seller sold the property at an amount that's only sufficient to cover the bond, there's not enough equity in it. So when it comes to 60 months later and we have to give transfer, and the seller, the purchaser says, okay, the agreement was I only pay 5,000 Rand a month, no interest, but the installment was 5,000 Rand plus interest, then the seller will have to pay in. There's going to be a shortfall on the side of the seller. Now, the question is going to be, well, I cannot raise the purchase price because they've already agreed on the purchase price. There's going to be a shortfall. The seller will have to pay in the shortfall when we come to transfer.
So I think this goes back to the conversation that we had last week. So, Alexa, from your side, I think you're on point on the requirements or the obligations when it comes to doing assessments if you're providing credit. So, to take it back a notch, this conversation is more around this conversation would then be around when you are providing credit. This is what you need to do. So to take it back a notch, we're going to say, do all installment sale agreements necessarily comprise credit agreements? So, for the sake of the viewers, just so they're aware, if you're not charging interest, then this isn't something that you really need to concern yourself with, right? If you are charging interest, different story, then you would have to be a registered credit provider, and exactly the assessments that Alex has been speaking about now, you'd probably need to undertake. Now, where the gray area kind of comes in is how do you structure this so that it doesn't fall within the NCA? So Alex, I don't know if you just want to touch on that quickly, just specifically to mention how you can exclude the NCA with juristic persons and simply not charging interest.
So obviously that would be the first, no interest, no other charges and no fees payable, then it doesn't apply. Then you have at arm's length, so that's loans between family members, partners, people that are codependent. Then you have between a stock file and a member of a stock file. And then the last one obviously being a juristic person with assets value or annual turnover of less than 1 million and a large credit agreement. So it must be more than 250,000 Rand.
Sure. And then, Leonora, do you agree with me that if you're charging rent for a person's occupation but not interest on the installment sale agreement, that the National Credit Act wouldn't apply to that because you're charging for occupation?
Yes, but you have to specify that in the agreement. So there will be to what Alexa said, there's no interest fees or charges, but then we have to, in the contract, facilitate that there is an additional amount of over and above the installment amount occupational rent payable. then the NCA will not be applicable.
Cool, awesome. Okay, anything else, guys?
No, thank you.
That's all awesome. For me.
Cool.
Well done, Alexa.